Final segment, Jason Burmes for the next 3 hours when the show ends in about 10 minutes. He's going to be in studio here for 3 hours, and I'm going to be in the last 30 minutes or so with him. I never got into our Joker contest, the huge success of putting up these Obama posters everywhere. It's made Fox News, Associated Press. They're putting them up in Tokyo, Japan, Los Angeles, California. It's crazy, but Jason Burmes has got Webster Griffin Tarpley, The Economist, on with him about the socialist government takeover of healthcare and the eugenicist Holdren. We're still on that coming up when this show ends. If your local station doesn't carry the show, it should, the Jason Burmes InfoWarrior program. But you can all listen at InfoWars.com or PrisonPlanet.com. Okay, we got about 10 minutes left here in the show with Dr. Ian Plimer. You talked about Hitler the environmentalist, Hitler who had to clean the earth of the scourge of humanity. And we see all these other scientists and people and Ted Turner and Prince Philip. If you go to an elite cocktail party, you know, with even elite academia, this is, they walk up and say, what do you think about the people bomb? I mean, when I was going to college, that was happening. Even the wannabe elites are into this. This really is their control freak religion. Can you elaborate more about what you discovered, what you cover in your book, about their mindset? And then finally, we're beginning to gain ground, it appears to me, against them, and they are starting to throw fits and get more and more aggressive. How do you see them trying to shut us up, and how do you see this battle playing out?
Well, it was interesting, your opening piece of music there was from Wagner. Now, Richard Wagner was Hitler's great hero. And Wagner was involved in the 1848 revolution in Europe. He was actually banned. He was actually involved in a revolution against government. And that led to massive immigration of the intellectuals from Europe to countries like the United States, to Australia. Europe lost its great people due to that revolution that Wagner was in. And yet Hitler used Wagner, who had totally different ideas, as his hero. And the interesting thing was that Hitler was also a vegetarian. And when we look back in the geological record, we've had human evolution has been very much driven by climate. And every time the climate has got cold, the vegetarians have become extinct. So there is a God in heaven after all. So we see some very interesting parallels. And we see many, many totalitarian governments that have views based on the environment. In China, we had Mao Zedong's views, where we had community health, which was driven by government, where we had community environmental programs. So we've seen this throughout history. Hitler wasn't the only one. We've seen it in the Soviet Union, where they took one line of science from Lysenko, who claimed that, oh, no, we can't have genetics operating because this means it's rather like a capitalist system. So he invented a type of genetics which created starvation, and about 30 million people died. And I was in the Soviet Union in 1977. I drove across from the northern part of the Soviet Union into Finland, exactly the same climate, exactly the same soils, but the wheat was about three times higher in Finland. So we've seen this many, many times before, people trying to put a political spin on the way in which we think, the way in which we eat, and the way in which we travel. So I think we are gaining considerable ground, and as I predicted in the last chapter in Heaven and Earth, that as soon as we start to bring up argument for which there's no answer, people attack us. So I've had merciless attacking by newspapers, by the BBC, by the Australian Broadcasting Corporation. They keep attacking me, but they don't argue the science. And as for going to elite cocktail parties, I have much better things to do with my time.
Well, by elite cocktail parties, any time I was in college, any time I've been around wealthy people, any time I've read any of their, it's just, it's all they seem to talk about is how they want to get rid of people and how the general public are rabble scum. And how the earth is dying and the people bomb. I mean, in college, didn't matter if it was math class, history class, psychology, anthropology. Every professor I had, except for an art class I took, came in during the school and said, there's too many people. We've got to have one-child policies.
And well, yes, yes, very much so. And I mean, this is why I'm spending a weekend here in a mining town. This is a mining town in the middle of the desert. These are real people. They can think, they're not stupid, and they're getting treated by the government as being stupid. They're getting treated by academics and scientists as being stupid. I really enjoy being in rural areas, agricultural areas and mining areas, because these are the real people, and these are feeling totally disenfranchised by the arrogance coming out of many of the college professors, the arrogance of government.
Doctor, going back to Mao Zedong, in fact, his Cultural Revolution, Great Leap Forward, it was eugenics-based. And then in the mid-70s, the United States and the UN and England funded China to set up the one-child policy. And if people have noticed, China's now embracing the selective carbon taxes, and people are shocked by that. How was the establishment able to sell this to the Chinese communist? Or is it just that communism believes in this vertical integration, so they like it because it's a pretext to take control?
Well, in China, for thousands of years, it's been a centrally controlled empire. We can't use the word government and China in the one sentence. And that control is on everything. What you plant, where, how many children you have, and the way you think. Now, the Chinese government is embracing carbon and carbon trading, which they will never put into practice. And the reason for that is that the great beneficiary of all of the carbon cap and trade, carbon trading, the great beneficiary is going to be China. We are basically going to be shifting huge amounts of money from the Western world into China. That's why they're saying they embrace it. And we are doing so many stupid things that the Chinese must be laughing. For example, we've had Earth Hour. For an hour on this planet, a billion people turned off their lights. But the power stations had to keep ticking over. And what happened was that these people were thinking, oh, we'll put less carbon dioxide into the atmosphere in that hour. What they did was their decrease in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere was equivalent to 6 seconds of China's emissions into the atmosphere. So we're seeing these religious exercises in futility. We are giving all the power, all the trade, all the wealth to China.
Well, Doctor, you just said it. They know it's a ritual to use the paper bag. They know, or the cloth bag. They know it's a ritual to have you submit to them. Just like it's a ritual to take your shoes off and be searched at the airport to be trained to be a slave. Enron got caught turning the power off a few hours a day in California. Their internal documents came out saying if we turn the power off, they'll accept a tripling in power cost. We're creating artificial scarcity. And so these social engineers cold-bloodedly know making everybody turn their lights off or turning the Eiffel Tower off is a symbol. It's a mind control. It's a Jim Jones programming that energy is bad and living is bad and having something is bad. And so you can give it to the government. And then all the promoters of the environmental cult, they have 4 or 5 kids, 10, 15 jet airplanes, palaces. Their carbon footprints are bigger than anybody's.
Well, very much so. And I think governments really have to understand that energy drives the economy. The more energy we have, the cheaper the economy becomes. The more energy we have, the more jobs we create. If we add costs to energy, we are putting people out of work. And if they're out of work, we can control them even more. And it only then becomes the elite who have a lot of money or those few people lucky enough to have a job that keep the wheels of the economy spinning. But I see that this is a process where we've got massive healthcare costs, where we've got controls on the way we think, the way we write. This is just another way of putting handcuffs on us.
Well, I hope to have you back up sometime during the weekday show so that audience can hear you, Doctor. Just
thank
amazing.
You,
the book is Heaven and Earth, Global Warming, the Missing Science. In closing, they do appear to be now, their facade of invincibility is breaking. Their hoax is beginning to be exposed, but they've got the governments behind them, so I think the fight is just beginning. I would just hope that you and other prominent people, as you've been doing, would just dispense with even arguing with these people and say, look, we know you're elitist control freak eugenicist and that you just want to kill the majority of the planet, because we have the hundreds of quotes from them. I mean, I think it's really time to even turn the heat up on these bastards even more.
Well, I agree. And they talk about opening their mind. My problem is that they've opened their brain so much that the brains have fallen out.
All right. Dr. Plimer, thank you so much for spending time with us.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you as you begin your day there in beautiful Australia. Take care. We'll talk to you again soon.
Thank you.
All right. There he goes, ladies and gentlemen. You can get all of my books and films and materials and my film Endgame about all this, Blueprint for Global Enslavement, on DVD at InfoWars.com, and the Obama Joker T-shirts that Big Brother really hates. I want to salute everybody out there for the great job they've done, and my crew. Jason Burma's coming up.